and you come up with the output. And one of the things he was telling is the technique, the mapping technique. What we've done here is within those broad range of analysis, you've got content analysis, where you analyze the content. And the one that you mentioned was NVivo. He's done that on NVivo. And then within that, gone into content analysis.
And he arrived at the based on NVivo.
Well, thank you very much. I think we lost a lot of our time, but I hope you have a good deal of advice to give. Right. So our last presentation will be from Dr. Khairi Omar. Dr. Khairi Omar is an assistant professor and head of department in our university, head of department of business administration. Today's talk from Dr. Khairi is the effects of human resources practices in Libyan banks. So from Saudi Arabia to Bahrain to Libya now, okay? Libyan bank sector on client behavior, intention to subscribe in Islamic finance system. That's a very long title, sir. So we are very much keen to hear your story. The floor is yours.
Okay.
Use the microphone.
Professor Abdullah Haji Abdulghani He is a professor in the management and traffic management basic and leadership at College of Business and University Malaysia, but unfortunately he couldn't make it to attend today. So what is the Sharia compliance or Sharia finance? It's a new terminology to some extent. Well, it is a system which governed by Islamic law, Sharia principles. And what is the features of this system? What is the fundamental feature of this system? They don't use or they get any interest for any product. So there's free interest for any type of financial product. And in fact, there is a lot of Islamic financial product going on in the whole world, and more than 500 financial institutions operating as compliance with Sharia financial system in the whole world. Also, there is around 38 countries, operating with fully fledged financial system in the world, where there is some countries they just offer dual system or just Islamic window in their banks. But unfortunately, in Libya, 2005, the country start saying, okay, we have to start dealing with the financial system. Well, Libya is a country which is full of Muslims. Of course, every religion or every follower of any religion, they used to follow the exact principle of that religion. So as a Muslim, we don't accept it. Usually, it is prohibited for the Muslims to deal with. But how come the country don't open such a bank or such a system to operate in their country? In fact, in 2005, they already start, but it was just on paper. It wasn't a real plan. So I decided to go further and to find why these banks are not operating very well, and why people don't go to those banks. Is it because of the culture? Is it because of some factors that nobody knows about them, or what? So the research objective was to determine the effect of service quality dimension. So I chose the service quality of offering by the bank itself, provided by the human resource management in Libyan banks on the behavioral intention of customers to subscribe the Sharia compliance financial system. And the second objective was, to what extent government support as moderating the relationship between the service quality, dimension, and the behavioral intention, effect on the relation between the service quality and behavioral intention to subscribe the Sharia financial system. So what is the hypothesis? There were two main hypotheses, which is service quality dimension, and we adopt the Carter model, because the service quality, as a shortcut of its service, it was just only five dimensions. But Osman, in 2005, he said he had another dimension, which is compliance. So the compliance was a very important dimension to measure, and we actually chose it. It was the first hypothesis. It was service quality dimension, Carter model, compliance, assurance, reliability, tangibility, responsiveness, and empathy will have a direct effect on customer behavior attention to subscribe the Sharia compliance financial system. Well, the second hypothesis, government support will moderate the relationship between service quality and customer intention to subscribe the Sharia financial system. So the methodology was, I used the quantitative method, and of course Libyan banks, customers or clients was the population of the study, and the data production was just by satisfied random sampling, and the population, of course, it was 3,868,416 public subscribers. The numbers are not fixed because of the subscribers are, adding or subscribing and withdrawing in such area. And we actually propose the two direct relationships and one indirect through the government support. elements provided by banks have an important role in the customer intention to join the SIF, which is Sharia Financial System, and the government support fund to be valid construct in the production of the intention to subscribe the Islamic finance system in Libya. The study also regards the lack of generalization because it is just contained of a few number of people, which is 226. And the Libyan government should give more attention to such markets when it is indicated that there is a very low support to this industry. It is important to for the government to work in line with the private sector, where the private sector, they have, from the results, you can see that the private sector, they are very interested in joining such industry, but in fact there is no Islamic banking system operating in the country. I think that's it, and sorry for my rushing.
Thank you for your presentation and being on time. Now we'll just open the few minutes for question and answer. Dr. Saeed, would you like to sit down here or there? Yes, please.
Thank you very much, I have a few remarks and then a question. I often hear to say that the German banking financing does not require interest.
I don't know how to do
it.
Because I just believe that it's a change, just semantic differentials. The commercial banks call it interest. The Islamic banks call it profit. Now, all of this is return on investment. Because, for instance, you said, okay, it is forbidden in Islamic law that interest be charged. But ultimately, the banks make profit. So I find it difficult. And if you look at the profit, I look at the interest charged by the conventional commercial banks, they all culminate into the return on equity or the return on investment. It's not that they change of semantics, that one calls it profit, another calls it interest, but ultimately it's a return on investment. I think that we need to be educated on that. That is on the one hand. Then I don't know the yen covered by your study. I don't know if you factored in the crisis in Libya as a disincentive for Libyans to be inclined to enjoy the services, in quote now, enjoyment quote, the services of these banks. So I think you need to be fully reflecting on that. Now, the mention about the fluctuation, it's not by population, it was not fixed because some people subscribe and equally unsubscribe. Then the question is, did you account for the fluctuation in the population in order to get the actual population size to determine the sample?
Thank you very much.
So answering your first question, it depends actually, depends on how we define the interest which is come from the product or the value added to the money when you bought it or how. Because it's very clear from the Quran in the spoken by the verse 2, there is a very big difference between dealing or stealing and using. It's a very big difference. How is it different? Because usually means I'm borrowing you money and after, let's say, 2 days, 1 month, 1 week, I get an interest on that money. When you get the money, I will get some additional money from that. And that's allowed in the and as you see, nowadays, people, because of this particular case, are suffering. Especially in the Western countries where they don't have any mercy to deal with the human behavior and transaction. So they don't care. Okay, I give you 1,000, you buy whatever, and after 1 month I have to get 1,000 that they can be. So this is the definition. We may need to read, because this is the most important thing. The concept itself, people are blaming. It's disregarding what the religion is.
Yeah, but I don't know. I wonder if you just have something.
We'll come back to you.
We'll come back to you.
I will go just like that. Is that fine?
And I have a question. This is interesting. There is a direction I meant to say. What is the difference between spend the money.
Yes.
Rather than spending the money itself. For example, I've got 100 dinar, for example, okay? I'm selling that 100 dinar and then to just worth it, you know, so I'm making, profit, anyway, interest, okay? By selling that 100 to you, and I'm getting 120. Okay, but indeed, it's not a thing, it's not a thing. You are actually selling the property back, you know, actually buying the property, and selling the property to you. So there is an exchange of deal.
For me, just a question is that now, your explanation is that you observe that you almost completing both. What do I mean? Because look at it, you sell money, then you earn revenue. Let's call it revenue now. In general, what is revenue?
Yeah.
You buy a property, you earn revenue. Now, what you are making is profit. If you mark it up, it becomes interest, a rent.
It's a whole debate.
Yeah.
Conventional banking and Islamic banking. I know this. It sometimes confuses. Okay, this morning I went to my bank, supposedly Islamic bank. They told me I give you a credit card with 3.5% per month. Do you call this interest? Do you call this return? That's another story. Let's go back to his. Let's go back
to the second.
To your topic, but from other comments. Yes, sir.
Okay, I just wanted to actually ask him one. I'm not really running back. I want to ask because I think the bank in Islamic banking they do like profit share, right? So if they lose, suppose you lose too. That's what makes it.
Yeah, it's a risk. Yes, it's a risk. Yes, that's right.
Okay.
Yes,
okay, so then my other comment was like, so how come, so in Libya there was no Islamic banks or they had them? I mean, why didn't they have? So what happened?
There's two types of Islamic banks operating in Libya. I mean, they sometimes use the fully fledged bank, which means the whole bank is Islamic bank.
In Libya?
وَأَحَلَّ اللَّهُ الْبَيْعَ وَحَرَّمَ الرِّبَى. This means riba, or what we call it interest rate, is totally prohibited by God Himself. So we as a human being, to a maximum limit, we cannot agree or disagree with that thing. This is the true belief on that verse. Let me now take you to another perspective. During the financial crisis back in 2008, when the financial market collapsed in the States and Europe, fortunately, France and UK start studying the phenomena of the Islamic banks. And after studying that phenomena, they figured out that to follow the process of the Islamic bank put you on the safe side. So it minimized the risk and it avoids the bankruptcy. However, there is a difference between what we call the commercial banks, the investment banks, and the Islamic banks. In the Islamic banking system, in the Islamic banking sector, they don't give you cash, they buy a product or a land, the bank owns it, then they transfer the ownership from the bank to the person, they put it in installments. Exactly. So if something went wrong, both parties will take responsibilities, so it's not a free risk as in the interest rank sector. So I think if I were in Dr. Khairi's shoes, we need to emphasize more and more in the mechanism of the Islamic banks. We need to convince Europe and the rest of the world about the meaning of the Islamic banks and how it works. Because still lots of people are confused about the meaning of the interest rate and the profit. It's not a profit, it's murabaha. And there is a big difference between a profit and murabaha. For those who don't speak Arabic, murabaha it's like sharing risk between two parties.
Based on the person.
Based on the person.
It's not shared.
Exactly. So I share with you the risk.
I will share with you a very short. Yeah. Back in 2012, the Economic Forum, I was in Dubai. I was participating in focus group sessions,
yeah,
with bankers like Deutsche Bank, Standard Chartered, BNP Paribas. They were big groups. We couldn't find any other product except the swap, which could be used from the conventional banking, the conventional finance to the Islamic one. All the other products, unfortunately, conventionally speaking, they have to include interest rates. The only one was swapping. Swapping the risk, I mean.
Yes.
I swapped
yes.
the risk.
Yes.
And that's the only product that could be, was very difficult for investment banks such as Deutsche Bank, for example, to work on this, particular issue.
It is not only distributing the risk. You know, the philosophy, the approach of the Islamic Bank is to enhance wealth. But, you know, what we call it in, I think, in old English, usury.
Illusion.
Yeah, this usury is forbidden because it will not contribute to sustainability, to the development of human beings or for their society. It's only focusing, and I think Shakespeare has, you know, in his The Merchant of Venice, you know, he describing such a practice. It is noticed in the old times, you know. It was accompanied with what we call it the Industrial Revolution or the emergence of bourgeoisie. You know, it leads us to problems. Now we are trying to solve it with discussing, conferencing about sustainability. I don't know, not sure if we will solve this problem. But Islamic banking is offering, you know, alternative. And maybe some practices in the Islamic banks, because Islamic banking not means that all Islamic banks following it. Maybe they put only the title. But you have to investigate this.
Okay, thank you very much.
Yeah.
I mean, just to tell you,
he's completely satisfied.
I'll just make him an obstacle. But I'm just going to give you perhaps my comment on this. You have a co-author, he's from Malaysia. In Malaysia, my knowledge, that's one of the best countries where the implementation of Islamic finance or the application of Islamic finance has been done so far. Now, what is his take on this when you have worked on an empirical study on the Indian, you know, Indian bank, Islamic banking professors? I mean, what's the take? I think he can, if he's a scholar who has really delved into that much detail in Islamic finance, I think there's a lot of things to, which means developing the assumptions. In other words, I think you have two assumptions, but I could see the first assumption you can interpret it into other smaller assumptions, perhaps, and not to focus only on the service quality affecting. I mean, just they have been validating the service quality and the carpet model. I don't know, is that right? And it was working in many other applications, but it's not about the carpet model. It's about your friend who wanted to buy a house. Yeah, back to the story. No, exactly. It's a very interesting. Back to the story of your friend who wants to buy a house, but he doesn't. He's reluctant. I mean, how this helps actually from a Malaysian perspective to a Libyan perspective.
Okay,
that's
good. Thank you. But in fact, the government support of the relationship has something to do with the character. The government can, you know, dissipate the culture or awareness among the people. People don't understand exactly. And there is a difference between the idea. I really look at the whole idea, how this works. Because due to the time, limit, I think, you know, it is a whole thing. But I can share with you the
whole. Thank you very much for attending this session.